Werner Memorial Presbyterian Church was organized as a Presbyterian church in the United States of America, the Northern Presbyterian Church, on September 19, 1893. The original congregation numbered 11. 2 members were received on profession of faith, and 9 were received by letter of transfer. By unanimous votes, 1 deacon was elected and 2 elders were elected in perpetuity. In addition, 6 trustees were elected, only 1 of whom was a member of the church. Services were originally held in the 2-room Kensington Elementary School house, which stood on the site now occupied by the Kensington Armory. Services were later held in the Noyes Library. Upon becoming a duly organized church under the ecclesiastical jurisdiction, the congregation desired above all to have a church building of their own. Brainerd H. Werner gave a large tract of land for this purpose and erected the building as a memorial to his father, Henry Werner, who had died in 1891. Henry Werner had been an active and much-loved elder in this community for many years. Werner Memorial Presbyterian Church met happily in its original building for 61 years. Over the years, the congregation grew along with Kensington, but during and after World War II, the congregation and church school grew quite rapidly. It was decided that a program of expansion required immediate action. On January 31, 1950, the congregation authorized, as would any good Presbyterian church, a planning committee. Elder Hawthorne Airy was elected chairman. At that time, Werner had 460 members and 305 children enrolled in the church school. The facilities of the original church were designed to house a congregation of 200. To handle the current church population, 2 services of worship and 2 church school sessions were inaugurated on February 12, 1950. The planning committee recommended that preliminary sketches for a new church plant be drawn, and on March 1, 1951, Elder Wilson L. Townsend moved that the congregation commission W.J. Hardgrove to do the preliminary drawings. As part of the process, the planning committee looked at other pieces of property. The lot where Temple Emmanuel stands was available, but the asking price of $40,000 was deemed too expensive. In addition, Potomac Presbytery representatives who attended the session meetings said, "You have an ideal spot here on the triangle." The Board of Trustees met on March 26, 1951. The chair stated the question to be resolved by the meeting was, "Shall we go ahead with the building fund campaign?" Mr. Carroll suggested a secret poll of the membership present to determine their intentions with regard to the amounts of their own pledges. 8 members responded. The resulting figure of $181,000 was a matter of some astonishment to those present. Mr. Carroll's demonstration apparently carried the day, for the trustees decided to recommend that the church set a campaign goal of $100,000 in sacrificial pledges and proceed with a fundraising campaign. On April 9, 1951, the congregation approved employing the Wells Organization to raise $100,000 in cash over a 3-year period. John O. Robin, M.D., was named Building and Fund Chairman. Through his untiring efforts with his committee, the congregation was pleasantly shocked to learn that $100,000 had indeed been pledged for the erection of the new church. Some members at the time recollect that it only took 1 month to reach this goal. Almost 2 years pass since Mr. Hartgrove, who drew up the preliminary drawings, had died. The congregation approved the preliminary plan submitted by McLeod and Ferreira, architects, on March 31, 1953. The congregation also directed the Board of Trustees to employ them as architects. Negotiations were begun to borrow the necessary funds. Through the efforts of Elder Charles M. Ireland, Jr., the Perpetual Building Association agreed to loan the church $207,000. The plans and financing were approved by the trustees of the Presbytery of Washington City, now part of the National Capital Presbytery. On October 19, 1954, bids for the new church were opened in the offices of McLeod and Ferreira. The bid of $255,000 submitted by Coleman and Wood Incorporated was accepted. At the same time, a bid of $12,750 for the expansion and installation of the enlarged organ in the new edifice was accepted from Lewis and Hitchcock. The last services in the original sanctuary and church school building were held on December 12, 1954 at 9:30 and 11 a.m. At the close of the 11 o'clock service, two deacons carrying the American and Christian flags, followed by Reverend Tredick, Harry W. McGinnis, and the congregation, left the sanctuary for the last time. They proceeded to the site selected for the breaking of ground for the new church. The site had been prepared, and when the sod was lifted, a white cross was seen in relief against the broken earth. As part of his sermon on groundbreaking Sunday, December 12, 1954, Reverend Tredick wrote,
"Today we stand ready to begin what 10 years ago was considered madness. In order to make this vision become a reality, 4 years ago, the congregation decided to raise $100,000 for a new church plant. Many thought that the minister was mad to lead with his chin in this endeavor, but we discovered what we could do with God or what God could do with us. Many of us have been impatient. I suppose I have been the most impatient of all, at least in the eyes of the chairman of the Board of Trustees. But we are brought up short with this concept of the fullness of time. Man cannot move until God is ready. The never-ending series of obstacles placed and at times seemingly thrown in our way made us more impatient. But man moves when God is ready. At such a time as this, we have mingled feelings. We've known for some time that the raising of our buildings would take place. But we humans never quite realize the full impact of some action until it is upon us. Many holy and loving memories are connected with this church. The memories will not fade with the demolition of the old buildings, which has served us so well. But your memories will be engraved deeper on your hearts. Our new church will in no way be a replacement of the old. That cannot be done. But in its silent dignity and simple beauty as we live in it, we will come to love it as much, if not more, than the old. The kingdom of God marches on, and we must march with it or drop out."
What had stood for 61 years only took 2 weeks to demolish. The 2 weeks were happy, yet sorrowful ones for the congregation, as they saw the demolition of the church buildings they loved so much. Some actually refused to travel Connecticut Avenue so they would not see the removal of the ancient landmarks. Longtime member Dot Snyder recollects, We, the Snyder family, had just moved into our new home at 3805 Calvert Place, across from the little white clapboard church up on the corner. Though we had been staunch Episcopalians, and our children baptized as such in Washington, D.C., I looked with longing at the location and proximity of this pretty church. How nice to walk to Sunday school and church. But Jack, my husband, was insistent that we at least begin our church life in Kensington by attending the Episcopal Church. Suddenly, we heard demolition crews roaring on the grounds of this little church. Our children and all the neighborhood children were intrigued. So were we adults. The grapevine informed us there was to be a new church built on this same property. Daily, I walked up to watch the proceedings. Soon, they were removing the shrubs and trees. A huge bulldozer was aiming at a lovely dogwood tree. I couldn't stand it. Approaching a gentleman, obviously a member of the church, I begged him to let me have the tree. Without hesitation, he not only said yes, but obtained permission for the bulldozer to deliver it onto our driveway. That gentleman was Cortland Townsend. To this day, we cherish that tree. And though I cannot say it was the deciding factor in our becoming Presbyterians, this incident certainly had a profound influence on my dear husband especially. And so we joined Warner Memorial Presbyterian Church. A significant loss in the building process was Warner's church bell. The bell fell victim to budgetary concerns. The sanctuary plans called for air conditioning, but no steeple. Oddly enough, Reverend Tredick insisted that the church have a steeple. Since there wasn't even enough money to put in the ductwork for air conditioning, restoring a steeple to the plans was an easy decision. The steeple added to the plan, however, was not strong enough to support the bell. The 1,500-pound, 36-1/2-inch bronze bell was cast in 1873 by the Henry McShane Bell Foundry in Baltimore. The bell was purchased by Eastern Presbyterian Church on Capitol Hill on August 13, 1878. However, Eastern's trustees decided to discontinue the ringing of the bell because its resonant tones were cracking the plaster in the facilities at 6th and Maryland Avenue. The trustees were delighted to find another church that could use the bell. Warner Memorial was just as delighted to have it. The bell was installed in a bell tower constructed on the east side of the Warner Church in 1895. The bell survived a cyclone in 1896, which caused the bell tower to tip over. A shorter replacement tower was built so that future storms might not again disturb the bell. The bell remained in Warner's Tower until 1955. It was regularly rung and scrupulously cared for by Mr. McGinnis. As the story goes, it was his baby. As a deacon, John Parse recalls his regular job of ringing the bell on Sunday mornings. 10 rings to alert the community that services would begin in 15 minutes, followed by one ring when the minister actually entered the pulpit. In the demolition process, the crane lifting the bell fell to the ground. The bell was not damaged in any way, so it was set off to the side of the triangle lot where it remained for several months. The McShane Foundry estimated its value at $500 as scrap metal. To get it off the lot while construction was underway, Tracy Coleman, the contractor's principal, moved the bell to the backyard of his home off Randolph Road, where it remained until 1958. No other church seemed interested in the bell, but Tracy Coleman, who was chairman of the building committee of Colesville United Methodist Church, decided the bell would be a fine addition to the bell tower of the new Colesville Church. And that is where the bell continues to ring, elegantly and regularly. By the spring of 1955, the new building becomes recognizable as the church we now know. The new sanctuary will seat 304, and the social hall will seat 299. The top floor will contain 8 classrooms and a treasurer's office. Besides the sanctuary with the updated organ, the main floor will contain an office, a pastor's office, 2 bathrooms, a parlor or bride's room, a nursery, which is now the office of the Christian educator, a common room with a kitchenette and a library, and a choir room. The lower level will contain a social hall with a stage and storage rooms, a large, well-equipped kitchen, a boiler room, 4 classrooms, and 2 bathrooms. Beginning Sunday, December 19, 1954, the congregation worshiped in the Kensington Junior High School. By arrangements with the Montgomery Board of Education and through the cooperation of the principal, Willard A. Shoemaker, the gymnasium became the roof for the congregation without a building. Several Warnerites actually attended the junior high, where Gertrude Gans, later known as Gertrude Bish, was the assistant principal, and Rebecca Stickley was an English teacher. Tiff, Julie, and Max Carroll were all students at the school. Max Carroll remembers that Gertrude knew everything and everybody. "I could get through the principal, but Gertrude, no, 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 no."
And now, ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. Someone once said that the world stands aside to make way for the man who knows where he's going. And so tonight it gives me great pleasure to make way for a man who knows what he's talking about.
Among the most active members of Warner at that time was Mr. Harry W. McGinnis. Best known at Warner as Mr. Mack, he only missed 7 church services between 1925 and his death in 1965, and he only missed those because of trips to Kentucky.
Real coffee beans, that's all there is. In Nescafe, 43 beans in every cup. Make Nescafe the all coffee in.
Bill Harris recalls that when he first arrived at Warner, Mr. Mack asked him,
"What are your politics?"
Bill answered, "Born and raised Democratic." Mr. Mack replied,
"First Democrat here in 40 years. Glad to have you."
After the building of the new church, Mr. Mack would follow the pastor out of the church each Sunday. He was always taking notes of what needed to be done for the following week. He also greeted everyone as they entered the church. Mr. Mack once worried that,
"Our grandchildren will still be paying for this building."
He refused to remove people from the rolls, even if they were deceased. After he retired from the government, Mr. Mack was a teller at the local bank, where he opened a savings account for Tiff Carroll. Kids would stop in the bank to visit him because he gave them lollipops. The bank people got mad and made him stop because it was drawing too many kids into the bank. He also helped the Harts get a safe deposit box. One Sunday, Mr. Mack greeted the Harts at the door and said,
"I understand you've been trying to get a safe deposit box at the bank. I think one is coming up. Would you consider becoming vice president of the men's club?"
Herb said yes, and sure enough, he got a safe deposit box shortly thereafter. Very soon after that, Herb and Betty became very active in the church. Chevy service is best. Steve Buckwalter recalled Mr. Mack as the glue that held it all together. He greeted everyone at the door and all the kids knew him. He was warm and friendly. As a child, Elizabeth Nye thought that Mr. Mack was God and that he owned the church. Bill Causey fondly remembers Sunday dinner at the McGinnis household with Mr. Mack and his daughter, Aria. Their kindness reached out to me and others with warm hospitality following worship on Sundays, winter and summer. Aria cooked and Mr. Mack helped her set the table. Aria made the best mashed potatoes in the whole wide world. Most whipped cream you'll ever taste is not as smooth as those potatoes when she got done with them. Dinner was a great mercy to tired clergy and musicians and a rich experience in more ways than one. Mr. Mack had a photographic memory for everything and everyone. I can almost see what Kensington and the Washington area looked like in 1900 when he arrived from the minefields of West Virginia because his descriptions were so vivid. His earthy and perfectly clear-eyed perception of events and persons made his endless stories powerful, entertaining, and educational. In poor health at the end of his life, he once said to me,
"You are too polite. You let me talk too much."
His honesty did not exclude even himself. What a man. Omar Buckwalter Jr. remembers that even on his deathbed, Mr. Mack said he was going to get well. He enumerated the things he was going to do for the church when he recovered from his illness. We have a very warm spot in our hearts for Mr. Mack and for his daughter, Aria. Fortunately, some deacons had station wagons. Hymn books were stored in the minister's garage. It took 3 trips to bring the hymn books to the junior high. A panel covered with felt was used behind the pulpit. The deacons were made up of 2 groups, one to get the hymn books and one to set up the chairs. While the worship service was held in the gymnasium, Sunday school classes were held in the first floor classrooms. Afterward, everything had to be taken back to the garage.
While the new building took shape slowly at first, by the middle of 1955, it finally started to resemble the church with which we are familiar today. The new church is oriented in the same direction as the old church. Gone are the separate buildings for the church, church school, and manse. The sanctuary, church school, and social hall have been combined into one building, and the manse has been moved to 4100 Glen Ridge Street. During the more than 5.5 years that elapsed between the original planning and completion of the new facilities, Warner had grown from 460 members and 305 children enrolled in the church school to 710 members with 600 children enrolled in the church school. Numbers that seem mind-boggling today. What some had once considered madness was finally coming to fruition. Members of that time recall that it was not uncommon to see 20 or 30 men working on a Saturday morning, painting, trimming bushes, scraping iron railings, building a creche at Christmas, and of course putting up a star and other lights. The session had 13 members, the Board of Deacons had 30 members, and the Board of Trustees had 18 members. In addition to a director of music, the music ministry had 6 people supporting it. The church school had a superintendent, 2 assistant superintendents, a secretary, and a moderator supported by 5 other people. The spire for the new church was raised on September 20, 1955. 30 to 40 men participated in landscaping the new grounds under the direction of horticultural expert, nursery owner, and longtime Warner member Carl Orndorff. The laying of the cornerstone was planned for October 9, 1955 at 3 p.m. The much anticipated day arrived, and on a beautiful October afternoon, a large crowd gathered for an outdoor worship service for the laying of the cornerstone. The program advised, quote, "This is God's house. Be reverent. Be silent. Leave it not without prayer to God for yourself, for those who worship here, for the nation, and for the world," unquote. The combined senior high and sanctuary choirs performed under the direction of Dr. Charles A.H. Chuck Thompson, with Mrs. Vincent as the organist. Reverend Tredick presided, and Elders Wilson Townsend, one of the earliest members of the church, and Mac McGinnis, ruling elder and clerk of session, prepared the articles to be placed in a copper box behind the cornerstone. The articles deposited in the cornerstone are a revised standard version of the Bible, a roll of church membership, a chronological roll of session, a chronological roll of pastors, a historical sketch of the church, the charter of the church, the order of service for the laying of the cornerstone, copies of the church bulletin, a copy of the Warner memo, a photo of the groundbreaking with names of participants, a photograph of the original church, a copy of Presbyterian Life, and a current newspaper. Reverend Tredick wrote, "The past is now prologue to the glory to which God, in His wisdom, has appointed for the congregation of the Warner Memorial Presbyterian Church. They face the future with courage and faith in the Lord God Omnipotent, who reigns in power and glory." The laying of the cornerstone was performed by the session's Committee for the Laying of the Cornerstone, Ray M. Skenk, Norman S. Meese, and Columbus S. Barber. One of the advantages touted about the new church is that it is fireproof. Another advantage touted is soundproof classrooms. One major change made in the new sanctuary was the addition of a choir loft. In the original sanctuary,
the choir had been up front, but comments about choir members falling asleep being a distraction put the choir and organ in the balcony of the new sanctuary.
A registered nurse in uniform would care for babies in the new nursery. At the time, there was no outside playground. In fact, when the session approved the weekday nursery school years later, it was with the condition there be no outside playground. Of course, an outside playground was eventually added, and the weekday nursery school, founded by Virginia Guest and Marcella Johnson, with a class of about 12, evolved into our current Learning Center for Young Children. Although the cornerstone had been installed in October of 1955, the congregation had to wait until March 18, 1956 to worship in the new building for the first time. Over 6 years after a planning committee to study the feasibility of building a new church had been appointed. The wheels of God grind slowly, but they grind exceedingly fine. In A Message from Our Pastor, Wendell Tredick writes of dedicating the new building.
"Dreams often come true, especially when they are inspired of God. Assuredly, the dream was given reality by prayer and sacrifice and work. But then that is how our dreams do come true. The brochure for our building fund was entitled Building to the Glory of God. This has been our guiding light ever since we began to prepare for this day. We recognized that God in His providence had set us here for a larger work than had ever been dreamed of in the early and middle years of this church's existence. The new building is a far cry from the original one. We are equipped and housed to do an excellent work. We have built a beautiful sanctuary and a well-equipped educational unit, but we must remember it is all to the glory of God, to the end that we might do a more efficient work for the living Christ. We must not succumb to the temptation to relax and be satisfied with what our hands have done. For unless God builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Down the future's broadening way, God is summoning us to greater works for His sake. As we dedicate this building, it will be in vain unless we rededicate ourselves to the world mission which Christ has set before us. Let us not be weary in well-doing. The future lies ahead, and it belongs to God, even as we do."
One 115 years of sharing faith at Warner
gives one some small sense of the timelessness of the Almighty. It is humbling to think that literally thousands of people have come through the doors of our new building, with thousands more yet to come. It is even more humbling to realize that God knows each of these persons and his or her own unique reasons for seeking Him. While some may not stay for long, many are led to know God, be part of a community of faith, and find friendship, family, fellowship, solace, joy, and home. Many not only have strong impressions of Warner Church, they also have lifelong memories centered upon it. James Trimble Marshall, Warner's first installed pastor from 1894 through 1905, reflects, "Someone has beautifully said that God gave us memory that we might have roses in December. My garden of memory is packed with roses of rare beauty and fragrance, and many of the rarest of these were planted when I was pastor of the Warner Memorial Church." In studying the history of Warner, one will find references to uncertain times, years of violent change, and living in a dark and confused time, when right seems to be on the scaffold and wrong on the throne. But one will also find many, many stories of generosity, compassion, joy, sharing, love, tenderness, humor, and the fellowship of food. Lois Bosch, Warner's first woman elder, points out that the real issue is how does the church change the world, not how the world changes the church. We will struggle, but Warner will always be my spiritual home. As Reverend Tredick reflected, the past is now prologue. Despite wailing and great gnashing of teeth, Warner continues to face the future with courage and faith in the Lord God Omnipotent. Warner's founding congregation of 11 could never have imagined what the future would hold, just as the 1950s congregation of 800 could not have imagined, nor can today's congregation imagine, but they certainly knew that the future is held in God's hands. A photo from the 1920s shows Warner's outdoor sign bearing the message, "Strangers, heartily welcome." Continuing in that spirit, we, the small band of brothers and sisters at Warner Church, persevere in our journey as we go forth, rooted in steadfast love and growing into God's future, with a strong sense that it matters to this one.